Morning, Calvary Chapel. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. Let's stand and praise the Lord.
We are hungry. Welcome to our first in-person service for about 8 weeks. So where y'all been anyway, huh? Great to have you worship with us on this special day, Mother's Day. And we're just so blessed. And do you think you got enough elbow room here today? Some of you have been waiting for this. Love this space. So anyway, what's going to happen the next few weeks? Your guess is as good as mine, because it's like something new every single week, shooting at a moving target. But we're anchored to the right bolt. As a friend of mine says, yes, I may be a nut, but I'm screwed onto the right bolt, and we're screwed into Jesus Christ, and that's what's important. So welcome, and welcome to those of you who are watching by live stream, and we'll try to get the glitches worked out, but bear with us, be patient. And of course, that's the mantra around here: be patient, be loving, be automatically forgiving, because we're charting uncharted waters. But the Lord's good, He's on the throne, we're trusting Him, we know how it's all going to turn out, we know He's got His hand upon our lives, He's got a great plan for each and every one of us. So the best is yet to come. And we can hear you talking up here, guys. So keep it low, if you will. Thank you. And it's just wonderful. We have a little video. Hopefully, it's ready to go. And that Doug Kaiser put together of some of the families, what they've been doing during this shut-in. So let her rip, Tater Chip. I guess we're ready to go. Hey, again, happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers. We're just so blessed that you're here. Just a few announcements before we share the word this morning. We do have masks available, not required, but if you're comfortable with a mask, by all means, we provided those. As you can see, hand sanitizers all over the place. We seek to comply with the lifting of the restrictions that the governor had upon our state. And, we will comply as best as we possibly can. They're not asking us not to preach the word or teach about Jesus. So we're good. So everything else we'll be flexible with. If there ever comes a time when they say, hey, you can't preach this in this man's name anymore like they did in the first century, then we'll have to say, I'm sorry. We're going to have to suffer for righteousness' sake, and we refuse to obey that order. Now, we're blessed here in Indiana because our governor has lifted these restrictions for church worship, with restrictions, of course. But some of our other brothers and sisters are still confined in other states, and there are pastors, Calvary pastors and other pastors, who have chosen not to obey because it's too oppressive, and that's between them and God. I know that in California, they have a restriction, except for today. I guess they lifted the restriction because they're going to let churches worship today because it's Mother's Day, but next week it goes back to no in-person worship. Well, some of you know Jack Hibbs, dear brother, we've had here speak, and then he's been a prophecy conference contributor for many years, either on the phone or live stream. He and 3,000 pastors, churches in California, are going to start their worship the 31st of May. Actually, they're starting tonight. They're meeting together on Sunday evenings in preparation for the 31st. So we need to pray for them. And I just pray that the governors around the state, and good brother Ken Graves in Bangor, Maine, he's holding his services. They've got a very oppressive governor in Maine. And so he said, I am ready to go to jail, the jail that I've ministered in so many times. That whatever it takes. He says, I know all the police officers. I know all the most all the sheriffs there. And so I'll have my friends arresting me if necessary. But, you know, isn't it too bad we've reached this point in America?
If you want to turn, if you have your Bibles, from Proverbs 31, verse 25 and following, especially verse 25, I saw this on Facebook today for our president's wife. they had this verse. I'm a part of a prayer group for the president, and they showed his wife, and they showed Proverbs 31 under her picture. And I especially like this verse, verse 25. They put this one as well on Facebook. Strength and dignity are her clothing. This is what a mother should be. Strong and dignified, and she should wear those like clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. My Bible says she laughs. She's not afraid of prophecy. She's not afraid to hear stories about the Lord's coming back, because this is in the Bible. There's 550 verses on the second coming of Christ, and we shouldn't shrink back from that, because that's the Word of God. And she's ready to go. Why is she ready to go? Because she opens her mouth with wisdom. That means she teaches God's word in verse 26. Teaching is on her tongue, and it's a kind teaching. It's not forceful. It's not angry at her children. She's not forceful with her children. She leads them with wisdom, and kindness is in her tongue, which they call it in this version the law of kindness. So the law of kindness is on her tongue. She makes it a rule to be kind when she speaks the truth in love, as it says Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15, speaking the truth in love. So it's good to speak the truth as mothers, but it's also good to use love with it, kindness, and just gentle wisdom. And that goes a lot further than anger. In 27, she looks well to the ways of her household, and no better time to look well to the ways of our household than now, when we have to be sheltered in at my age group. Looking well to the ways of your household. Now we have more technology to straighten things out with our kids. We can talk to them on FaceTime. We can Google them. We can Zoom them. It doesn't just mean your physical household, like the walls, like cleaning and cooking, which is what we do a lot of now. We don't go out to eat. So not only that, but the household of your spiritual household, which is your children and their children, and your friends that you've led to Christ. It's time to spend time looking well to that household. And this is our household that God has given Joe and I, but yet it's been scattered for a while. And the way that God showed me to look well to my household as a mom is to write letters like we used to do in the old days. And some of you have received a letter from someone in this church in the last 2 months. If you're a member of this church, you might have received a card. Because one day I woke up thinking, I need to look well to my household. My church household is apart from one another. They might feel isolated and uncared for. Let's send out notes to the ladies of the church. So Karen and I brainstormed, and she and I came up with a plan. She's the planner. I'm the idea lady. I wake up with these ideas, and then we walk at the park, and we talk about it. And so that's in one way we can look well. We can send letters to our parents that are sheltered in. We can send phone calls, cards, whatever it takes to show that you're looking well to your household. And in 28, her children rise up and call her blessed. So they may not be blessing you today. They might be blessing you out rather than blessing you spiritually. They don't understand your ways, why you follow Christ. They don't understand why you're so old-fashioned. And was the world black and white when you were growing up? What's the deal with you, Mom? But you're planting seeds in these kids, and you can think, someday they're going to rise up and call me blessed. And in the way that the children call their mothers blessed, in the best way is imitation. When the children see how their mother raised them, and maybe they rebelled against it, but when they start having children and their children's children, they begin to reflect their mother's care, their mother's wisdom. And that's one way they rise up and call you blessed. They may never say the words, but imitation is the greatest form of flattery. And you see your children imitating you, you'll see it come out in things they'll say and how they handle problems. And you'll think to yourself, I remember they were around when I handled that problem. They saw me do it. And it's kind of a really good feeling to know that your children will rise up. And her husband also, it goes on to say, her husband in that verse also will praise her. So he has something to brag about. And I really appreciate husbands who don't rag but brag. It's a good thing to do for a wife. Is she doesn't want to be ragged, she wants to be bragged on. And so brag on your wives in little ways when she's present. Brag on her when she's not there. Brag on her as a mom to your relatives and to your kids. And this is the best way to keep the family in a unit when the father is bragging on the mama, and they see that mama's admired and respected by the husband too, and not just the kids rising up. Many women have done virtually well, verse 29, but you excel them all, the one who follows these principles. Charm is deceitful. Beauty is vain because it doesn't last. But a woman who reverences the Lord will be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. So as you go forward as a mama, and your mama, as you look back on your own mom and how she was fruitful, then you'll realize God is good. He's given us good moms, and moms are the stability of our society. So keep praying for your moms. God bless.
Okay. Thank you, Mama Bell. We're aware, for those of you live streaming with us, that we have a technical glitch, and Karen just texted me and said that to keep recording because she can adjust that in the archives. So later on today. So if you don't get a right sync with the lips and the sound, it's on its way. You know, our hearts go out to those who have lost their mothers. Many of us don't have our mothers with us anymore. They've gone on to heaven. If they've known the Lord, and a special mama that just died this past week or so, Debbie Johnson, and we were shocked that she left us at such an early age. I talked to her son Adam this week, and he gave a wonderful testimony of her life and how he had noticed a change in her life since she'd been coming here, and that he noticed all these Christian books and Bibles that she didn't really have before. And so he said that he noticed that she was just growing closer to the Lord. And she was excited. She was going to be in the choir. But that's not going to happen now. She's singing in a better choir, a heavenly choir. So, again, our hearts go out to Debbie's family. We're going to have a memorial service at the gravesite in Thorntown this Wednesday. And they've asked me to say a few words, and I'm honored to do so. But God bless the families who don't have their mothers with them any longer. They're precious. God knew what he was doing when he created mothers. And I'd just like to share a few scriptures with you this morning in John chapter 29, verses 26 and 27, a beautiful passage. You have your Bible. I'm going to launch from there. I'm going to share some other scriptures, but this is kind of what we're going to begin and end on is John chapter 19, verses 26 and 27. And if you're looking for me to be in the book of Revelation, I will be back in the book of Revelation next week. And talk about a great place to pick up. We're in heaven in Revelation. So we're going to heaven next week. And it's describes the splendor of the throne. Just absolutely gorgeous. And so we'll never be disappointed. I like what Chuck Smith used to say when he was teaching on Revelation chapter 4 and 5. He said, you really need to learn this and learn it well so that when we get up there, you're not going to walk around like a bunch of country bumpkins. You're like, oh, my. So we're looking forward to getting back in the book of Revelation in chapter 4 next week. But let me read John chapter 19, verses 26 and 27. When Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, that would have been John, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, the disciple took her into his home. Really a touching passage of how Jesus cared about his mother, even though he was leaving, he was dying, and he cared about what was going to happen to his mother. And he left her in the care of the Apostle John. Now, it's interesting, as we've been studying the book of Revelation, we know that John was banished to the Isle of Patmos. He was in his near 90 anyway, and so he's pretty old. But church tradition says that when John obeyed Jesus' words from the cross and he took Mary, the mother of Jesus, he moved to Ephesus, and he lived in Ephesus for many, many years. In fact, he was banished to the Isle of Patmos when he was ministering in Ephesus. And so the question is, well, what happened to Mary at that time? Some have suggested, well, she went with him to the Isle of Patmos. Not too much evidence of that, but some have suggested that. But the reality is, she had probably already gone on. She probably already died because she would have been very old at the time. But John did get a reprieve. He was pardoned by Emperor Nerva, the next emperor that came on, and he went back to Ephesus and probably died there. But Mary probably died there in Ephesus or in the area of Ephesus, maybe a suburb, we'd call it today, of Ephesus. But John, according to all tradition and some of the church fathers, were very adamant that John did care for Mary the rest of her life. Well, here's some inspirational quotes about mothers. Mothers hold their children's hands for a short while, but their hearts forever. We never know the love of a parent until we become parents ourselves. And we can certainly identify with that, those of us who are parents and grandparents. Our twin grandsons, Ben and Noah, turn 13 years old today on Mother's Day. And we had their with their mother today. So we had a party for them Friday. And I'm my head's spinning. I can't believe these guys are 13 years old. Precious little guys. I mean, just you know. Well, you know, I'm prejudiced, and so is their grandmother. George Washington said, "All I owe to my mother." Abraham Lincoln said, "I remember my mother's prayers and they've always followed me. They have clung to me all my life." And a mother is the bank where we deposit all our hurts and worries. And that author's unknown, but that's so true. Moms, you've done a wonderful job in raising your children, and they can lean on you. You know, fathers are very important. We know that, but mamas hold the critical role. They're in the home most of the time. They're with the children most of the time. In our world today, sadly, when husbands and fathers decide to be unresponsible and they leave the home, the babies are usually left with the mother, and they've got a tremendous burden on their shoulder, as well as the blessing of the children. Well, speaking of prayer, mothers and women of the Bible produce great fruit in their families' lives as a result of prayer. Just a few of the women in the Bible that were prayer warriors. Deborah prayed for victory over her enemies, then praised God for the victory. Ruth prayed and God brought Boaz into her life and restored her mother-in-law back to faith. Hannah was unable to become pregnant. She earnestly prayed, and God brought along a little prophet by the name of Samuel. Abigail prayed for her husband who was about to be killed, and God protected him. In fact, he's about ready to be killed by her other husband, and that was David, who became her husband after Nabal died. Esther prayed for her people, and God spared them. Mary, of course, the mother of Jesus, prayed. And see a little bit more about Mary in a moment. Mothers, just keep praying for your children, especially in these days. They have fears and uncertainties, and I know you do too. this coronavirus has just upset the balance of things. We're just kind of out of balance. We're not sure what's going to come next. Or is the second shoe, the other shoe going to hit us this fall? And we're going to have to go back to being quarantined again? You know, we don't know. We just don't know. We don't know how the global elite is manipulating this as well. Things can get out of control. They have certain designs and plans for things, and then all of a sudden, it's out of control. But we know who is in control, and we know who holds tomorrow, and that's Jesus himself. So he's worthy of our praise, and he's worthy of our prayer, and he's worthy of our confidence, because there's no fear in love, and he's the ultimate in love. But perfect love casts out fear. Paul says to Timothy. So prayer is so critical. Several mothers in the Bible. Eve was the first mother. Genesis chapter 3, verse 20 says, "The man called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living." Sarah was a mother because of a miracle in Genesis chapter 21, verses 1 through 3. "The Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time at which God had spoken. Abraham called the name of his son who was born, to him from Sarah, Isaac," which means laughter. So God brought laughter into their home. It's kind of interesting how some kids just bring joy and laughter into your life. All of them do to an extent, but some just, you just have to chuckle. Rachel, the mother of Joseph, was the first mother on record to lose her life in childbirth. Genesis chapter 35, verses 16 through 18. "Then they journeyed from Bethel when they were still some distance from Ephrath. Rachel went into labor, and she had hard labor. And when her labor was at its hardest, the midwife said to her, 'Do not fear, for you have another son.' And her son was, as her soul was departing, for she was dying, she called his name Ben-Oinah. But his father called him Benjamin." Mary of Salome. You know, there's six Marys in the New Testament, and it's easy to get some of the Marys mixed up. But this was the Mary of James and John, who was very interested in her son in the future. She wanted them to have a special place in God's kingdom. She had ambition for her son. So the mother of the sons of Zebedee came up to him, up to Jesus with her sons, and kneeling before him, she asked him for something. And he said to her, "What do you want me to do for you?" She said to him, "Say that these two sons of mine are to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your kingdom." Talk about an ambitious mother. I think most mothers are very ambitious and have high hopes for their children. And this Mary did it as well. But Jesus said, "Well, that's not for me to decide. That's in my Father's purview." And God did have a very special plan for them, but not quite that. Incidentally, he has a special plan for all your children. That's why we pray, "Lord, fulfill that plan that you have for their life." And you know, he's got the perfect will for your children. And so that's why when we see them going contrary to the things that we know are of God, what do we do about that? Panic? No. We hold true to the Word of God. God's Word is true. It's going to come true in their lives. But God wants us, our little feeble faith we have, to connect with the Word of God and let the Holy Spirit fulfill it. He will. Don't give up. Sometimes we need to be persistent in our prayer, and never give up on the perfect will of God for our kids. Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist, was righteous. In Luke chapter 1, verses 5 through 6, in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth, and they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commands and statutes of the Lord. And of course, God blessed them, and they had a beautiful son by the name of John the Baptist. Mary, the mother of Jesus, she's a role model in the scripture. Now, we don't venerate her the way that some traditions do, but we honor her and we recognize her as a great role model for mothers. For example, she was submissive, Luke chapter 1, verse 38, and Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. She submitted to what God was speaking through this angel. She was humble, Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 48. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in the God of my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed." And they have, and we do. She was obedient, Luke chapter 2, verses 22 through 24. "And when the time had come for her purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him," that is Jesus, "up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it was written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons." So they submitted. They were, Jesus was born under the law. Joseph and Mary were born under the law. They were submitting to the rule of the day, and they took Jesus to the temple and made the purification that they were required to under the law of Moses. So she was obedient. And in the end, she was protected. And she was protected by her son's prayers, Jesus, and as he declared to John from the cross, I'm paraphrasing, "John, take care of my mother." And John did. And from all the history and tradition that we're aware of, he did an excellent job, protected her until her death somewhere up in Ephesus. So what a great role model Mary was. She's not the only great role model in the scripture of mothers, wonderful role models. And you know, some of you are wonderful role models too. You're praying for your babies and your children and your grandchildren, and you're holding them up before the Lord, asking for God's hedge of protection about them, asking that God would fulfill his plan in their lives. If they're away from the Lord, that God would bring them back. He hears those prayers, mothers. So one of the greatest things that you have in your life is praying for your children and for your grandchildren. Let's do that now. Let's lift up our children and our grandchildren. Father, I just want to agree with my brothers and sisters here this morning, but especially the mothers and the grandmothers, for their children and for their grandchildren. Lord, you love their kids, and you love their grandkids. And we know it's very challenging in this world that we live in, and all the temptations and all the lures of the world, not to mention what Satan is trying to do to corrupt our children and the young people in this generation. Father, we do pray for your hedge of protection about our children and our grandchildren. I agree with the mothers and grandmothers who are praying for this right now. I pray that you raise up young champions, Lord God, to contend with the forces of evil that we're faced with today. I thank you for all the children that have been raised in godly homes and
the scripture has been instilled into their hearts, and we know it's going to come home. Your word will not return void, but it will accomplish what it's sent forth to do. And so we know that some of those seeds that have been sown, they're gonna come home. Those seeds are gonna bear tremendous fruit. Lord, some parents are concerned, and grandparents are concerned about their children who are older now, and they're not walking with you. They're not close to you. Lord, you can change that too. You care. And in this challenging generation that we're living with COVID-19, Father, everyone's asking questions. What's going to happen next? How did this happen so fast? Well, Lord, we pray that you answer those questions in the hearts of the children and the grandchildren with, you have a plan, you have a purpose, and they're a part of that purpose in these strategic times. And the first thing that you want them to repent and get their hearts in tune with you. And then, Father, begin to fulfill that plan that you have for their lives. You said in Jeremiah 29:11 that you know the plans that you have for people, plans for a future and a hope. And Father, though that was given to the nation of Israel, and you will fulfill that in the future, what a wonderful application of that promise for mothers today. So Lord, we thank you. Thank you for bringing us here. Fulfill the great plan that you have for our children and our grandchildren. And bless these mothers, Lord God. Encourage them. We pray for good health in their lives. And God, Father, those who have lost mothers, I think of Stephanie Whitmore, who lost her mother this year. A godly woman, a beautiful woman. Cheryl, a woman who contributed so much to this local body. We just pray that you bless Stephanie on this first Mother's Day with the loss of her mother. Comfort her with your Holy Spirit, Lord God, and her family, in Jesus' name. And all those who have lost their mothers, Father, this is a day we remember them, we honor them, we think of them, and thank you for the wonderful memories that you've given to us about our moms, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, onward, Christian soldiers. God bless you.